So let's say you have the data. What do you do next? Well, one of the first things you would want to do is take a look at that data, just glimpse through it and get a feel for it. But then very soon you'll want to convert it into a form that's useful for you, effectively transform the data so that you can do the analysis on top of that. And you'll also almost certainly want to clean up the data because it's very unlikely that the data is perfect in every shape or form. For example, if let's say it's marks data, you may find that the marks that for students who haven't attended are filled in as NA or absent. And you'd want to decide whether you want to ignore those students or give them a zero or give them the same mark as the average, or what do you do in each of those cases? And perhaps if it's spelt as absent, it won't even load in your data set as a number. It'll say, well, absent is not a number, so I can't even load it. So these are the kinds of things that we'll be looking at in this module. How does one preview the data? How does one transform the data? And how does one clean the data? Let me share one of the most interesting experiences that I personally had with regard to cleaning and transforming data. This was during the 2014 elections. During the general elections, we at Gramner, we were doing the election coverage for CNN and IBN, working with Microsoft. So this was a case where the entire world was watching because our search engine, that is Microsoft search engine Bing.com, was going to be pointing to our website, and people are watching on national television literally in real time. And we have to come up with insights from live as well as historical data. So how did that work? Well, the Election Commission website had data that was in the form of PDFs, hundreds of PDFs for each of the states. For each of the years, there were PDFs that were available, and we could pull these off. Let's take a look at what those PDFs would look like. Here's an example of the 1985 Maharashtra Legislative Assembly elections. So there are a list of parties, abbreviations, highlights, blah, blah, blah. And then finally, apart from all the summaries, you have the detailed results section where for each constituency, it shows this particular candidate who was a male from the Indian National Congress got 25,000 votes and won with a 44.61% of the overall votes. It also shows the total number of electors, what is the poll percentage, valid votes, and so on, and does this for each of the constituencies all the way up to constituency number 288, which is the total list of constituencies in Maharashtra in 1985. Now, we have this data and we need to get it into a form that's usable. So effectively what we needed to do was taking the structure that we have, convert it to begin with to a text file that can kind of be processed. And then from that text file, extract it to a structured format like this Excel that you see. How did that work? Well, let me show you the script that we used for that. You will be going through how to do things like this as part of the course, but I'm going to give you a broad sense of what we did. We opened the election statistics website, and then within that, we took all of the rows from the second table. So you'll notice that the data has two tables, or the page has two tables. The second table is where all of the information is. And within that, we were looking at all of the links and extracting those link information and then saving those as PDF files. So that gives us a set of results like this. And for pretty much every single one of the constituents, for every single one of the states, for every year, we now have a file. That's step one. Step two is converting that into text. So it turns out that there's this tool called XPDF, and it has a command PDF to text, which uses a layout option. And what that does is converts text like what you see here into something that, well, these are not really tables. These are actually pieces of text with lots of spaces or tabs in between. So the minus layout option, it turns out, is able to take a PDF and convert it to a piece of text that looks visually like the PDF, which is pretty clever. So this is what the same Maharashtra 1985 election results looks like. So you'll see that it's got text that's formatted roughly the same as what you see visually. There's some slight differences here and there, but it kind of looks like what we would have in the actual visual itself. So if we go all the way to the bottom, we can get for a given constituency, connected the candidate number, their name, their gender, and so on and so forth. So how does one parse this? Well, the script continues to after converting all of the files into PDF, it parses the text from those PDFs. How does it work? Well, it says, well, I will start parsing once we have the detailed result section. So how do we identify a detailed result section? So it turns out that the word detailed results is there only in the section that has detailed results, not even in the table of contents. It turns out that they call it detailed result in the table of contents, but in the actual results, it's called detailed results, which is helpful. So I can just start parsing when we get to detailed results. But this is not true for every PDF. Each PDF has its own structure. Well, almost 99% of them, they follow the same structure. But Goa in 1989, for example, does not have that structure. This is the Goa 1989 file. And you'll see that the detailed results actually doesn't have a heading detailed result. It just starts off with the details of the constituencies. So what we do instead is say, well, if detailed results is not there, then look for the word candidate, then party, then votes. The first line that has this is the one that you can start parsing. This is also true for Uttar Pradesh in 1996, Gujarat in 2012, just a few exceptions. Now, if you haven't reached this line, then just continue until we get to this line. Only then we start parsing. Otherwise, what we do is keep parsing till the end of the file. But Uttar Pradesh in 2002, towards the end, has a statistical report section, which no other report has. So all the other reports pretty much end with the details of the constituencies, but only in Uttar Pradesh 2002, we have this report. So in that case, stop parsing it. We don't want to go beyond the list of constituencies. And then get the constituency name. How does one figure out the constituency name from a statement like this? Well, what you can do is ignore the word constituency. So just if it starts with constituency, ignore it. If there's a number, if there's anything other than a number after it, like constituency, colon, and all of that, ignore all of that. Sometimes constituencies also have, after the details of the constituency, sentences or phrases like number of seats, total electors, and so on. Get rid of all of these. And what that will leave us with is the number and the name of the constituency. So get the assembly constituency number by parsing for the number and the name of the constituency, which must be alphanumeric, but it could contain full stops, hyphens, and so on. Some constituencies are also marked as SC or ST. So let's take an example of a constituency. Dargalim in Goa is marked as a scheduled caste constituency. So we need to extract that information as well. But not all constituencies are marked as SC. So Thivim, for instance, is not marked as SC or ST. In that case, just assume it to be general. And then we loop through all of the candidate details. So get the candidate's name, get the candidate's number, get whether they're male or so on. And all of that uses a series of specific parsings which have different exceptions in each of these files. As you can see, it's a fair bit of manual effort. And what we've done is written an application that automates it across hundreds of files, but getting to that piece of code itself is a fair bit of effort. So if you're going to be processing data, then you'd better be clear that it is worthwhile. Now, at the end of the process, what we have is a cleaned up CSV file, cleaned up, so to speak, where we have the state in this particular year for assembly constituency number such and such with a certain name. So in Ichapuram in Andhra Pradesh, which is a general constituency, candidate number one, Uppadaranga Babu, who's a male, whose age is not specified and whether he's SCST or not is not specified, from KLP, the party, got 14,565 votes and won because that's the largest number of votes in this constituency. So we have this information and that's a reasonable amount of data, about 300,000 rows and a bit more where the constituency, okay, no, sorry, 400,000 rows. Now let's take a look at the structure. Is this clean? So if we do a quick pivot table, Let's say we take one particular state, Andhra Pradesh, and look at each constituency and how many candidates stood for election in each year. So in Achampet, nobody stood for election in 1955 and 1957 because there were many constituencies that were created in 1962. That's fine. And from then on, there were two, then four, then two, three, and so on, all the way we have candidates up to 2014. Now, let's look at something unusual. Let's take Amberpet. Amberpet only had elections starting in 2009. But that's okay. There were some constituencies that had elections only, or that were created only after 2009. But let's look at this constituency. Allagada had elections only in 1972, not before, not after. Now, let's look a little closely. If you look at the constituency spelt before it, clearly this is a spelling error or change. It was spelled with two D's up to 1967, then suddenly spelled with a HD in 1972, and then they changed it back to two D's. So this is an example where you obviously want to combine these. It's really the same constituency. And you'll see several examples of this. Ammanaburulu. Now, 1955 and 1962, but we don't have anything in the middle. And did it stop? Is it renamed to something else? You'll see several such examples. Let me give you a feel for some such. Arbhavi and Arabhavi. So 1967 is when it started, but then goes on to a different spelling after 1978. Athani is up to 1957 spelled without two A's, and then starts with two A's from 1962 onwards. BTM layout has a full stop in 2008 at the end. It does not have a full stop at the end in 2009. There are hundreds of such examples. So you could either manually clean them up, which is pretty difficult, or you could use the data itself to see whether there are matches, perfect mismatches like this. Aland, which is spelt in one particular way, and Aland, which is spelt in a slightly different way, and then see if they match. Another thing that you could do is match the similarity in the phonetics of this. Arabhavi, Arbhavi, they sound the same. Aland and Aland, they sound the same. So that's one of the things that we used. Kundapura and Kundapura, they sound the same, though alphabetically they may be placed very far away, and they're actually the same constituency. So using that kind of a phonetic similarity, we were able to match a fair number. And how exactly did that phonetic similarity come about? Well, we were using OpenRefine, which is one of the tools that you'll be learning about in this module, and it's got a whole series of methods by which you can figure out if two columns or two values are similar. So in our case, it did stuff like this. It said Madira, Madira, Madur. They sound like the same constituency. Do you want to combine them into a single one? Devarkonda, Devarakonda, Devarkonda. They all sound the same. Do you want to merge them? So we just put a tick against the ones that we want to merge, and then it becomes a single constituency name. It automatically renames it. Now, incidentally, the way it figures out what the target name should be is based on a simple heuristic, which is the most common constituency name. So if Bhadrachalam is spelt 48 times in a certain way, then use that as a default, but you can then override it with whatever constituency name you choose. Now, with this kind of a procedure, we were able to catch most of the phonetic variations, but we also needed to complement it with this kind of an approach. That's because there were a few cases that were really hard to match. Let me give you an example. Bandar is the same as Machilipatnam. The constituency was actually renamed. These sound nothing like each other, but they did in fact have to get matched. And the only way we could figure it out was because the data was showing us that this is one mismatched constituency. Now, this is something that we have to apply for, not just constituency names, but party names. MADMK is the same as MAMAK is the same as MDMK. And the party names can change over time as well, so that requires a certain amount of effort. So what is now called AIADMK used to be called ADMK or ADK. Parties can restructure. So there was a time when the Indian National Congress split into Indian National Congress Indira. But that became the mainstream Indian National Congress and then was simply renamed back to Indian National Congress. So even though technically it's a different party, people consider it the same, and therefore you have to factor these in. And of course, we have to handle spelling mistakes in the constituency names. Now, all of this goes into data transformation and data cleansing. And this is the kind of stuff that we'll be looking at how to do. A whole series of stories emerged around this, ranging from which party had the highest margins, lowest margins, most voters, and so on. But one that I was particularly fascinated to see on television was the story of the most persistent party. It turned out that the Doordarshi party in 1984 had contested in 97 seats without winning a single election. And that's pretty much a record. But in 1989, they continued the same. They actually fielded 298 candidates in 298 constituencies, and even there had zero wins. But they didn't stop there. In 1991, they extended to 321 candidates. And at this point, they were the second largest party in terms of the number of candidates. Other than the Congress, they fielded the second largest number of candidates, ahead of BSP, ahead of Janata Dal, ahead of BJP. And across these, they won exactly zero. So with a total of almost 800 elections, they had won zero votes and zero seats. And not just that, in each of their constituencies, they never even came runner-up. At best, they were number three, and that was mostly in the constituencies where they only had three candidates in the first place. Yet another interesting story that was played out was the total number of candidates that stood for elections in each constituency and where this was the largest. So in the 1967 assembly elections in Tamil Nadu, for instance, each of these circles represents one constituency, and the size of the circle represents a number of candidates. So in Basin Bridge, there were four candidates, but this is the largest circle, Perambalu, and there were 10 candidates there. So overall, nothing really stands out. In 1971, again, nothing quite impressive. In 1977, you see two things. One, the color changes. The color represents the winning party. So it's now become ADMK that is leading in or won in most constituencies. And the size has increased a little bit, partly because there's a new party in the mix, but mostly there isn't too much of a shift. 1980, nothing much different. 1984, though, we now have 90 candidates standing for election in one constituency. And you can see that most of these are independent candidates. And they barely got 20-odd votes, 19, 18 votes, and so on. But this was certainly an outlier. In 1989, there were a lot of new candidates, but no outliers. But in 1991, we now have Pallipet, where 264 candidates stood for election. And Avarakuruchi, where 249 candidates stood for elections. Now that's huge. I mean, at this point, it's almost like a pamphlet that you have to flip through to find the candidate to vote for, right? But all of this pales in comparison with the 1996 elections at Modakuruchi, where there were 1,033 candidates standing for elections. Now with 1,033 candidates, it's not a pamphlet, it's a book. It's probably the telephone directory of Modakuruchi that you're voting in. And if you look at the names of these candidates, so let's run through this. So we have, for example, Palanisami K, Palanisami K, Palanisami K, Palanisami K. I mean, there are five Palanisami Ks. And if you had to figure out which Palanisami K to vote for, it's going to be a bit hard because there's no other identifier. The party is the same, their independents, and their name is the same, which is incidentally probably why we have as many as 88 candidates got exactly zero votes, meaning they stood for election and didn't even vote for themselves. So in all, you see that with the ability to clean data well, you actually have a competitive edge because cleaning data is hard, and what clean data can give you is so much more powerful than the unclean or raw data. So that's what you'll be learning in this module. How can you use tools to get data to the form that you want and clean them up? To begin with, we'll be looking at number one, what are the tools you can use to load and preview the data? Specifically, we'll be looking at Excel and we'll be looking at Pandas profiling. Second, you'll look at how you can create derived metrics from that data, add new columns that will give you new information, transform the data in different ways, and you'll be looking at Google Sheets, you'll be looking at Excel as a tool, but you'll also be looking at Trifacta's Wrangler as another tool that will help you do this. We won't restrict ourselves to just text. You'll also learn how to transform image data using the Python image library or the newer version, which is Pillow. And finally, you'll also learn how to clean or correct missing data, which you can do with libraries like Tabula for PDF files, which will help you extract tables. You can do with tools like OpenRefine, which will help you work with structured data and correct spelling mistakes, for example. And you'll also learn how to do image labeling for images using simple tools like Excel. To recap, this module will give you the tools that will hopefully provide you a competitive edge when it comes to taking data that is raw and converting it to data that is useful for analysis.